incredible? No, I'm a human being. Just first of all, I'm the one that is grateful to be here. I did start a startup too, that it was based on how to share menus, you know, for the restaurants around the area, you know, to the companies that were around. It was a disaster. So I continue, you know, like on my corporate life. And when I was thinking on what to share with you, the truth is that you, the ones that are in the startup world, for me, you are the heroes. It is much better and easier for me to be incorporated. So first of all, I didn't know what to share that you could learn. So I'm going to share three things. One that I think is relevant for corporate and for the startup. One is related to the company culture that you are setting up and how relevant it is. Second is that whatever you do, it's all about people. And third, that you all, as leaders, our colleagues, as founders, we need to think on what is the leadership style you have and the impact that you have in the company and in the people that you are building. So that's my learnings. To start with it, so let me start like introducing myself. This is myself when I started in HP. This is around 1992. So you can do the calculations, how long have I been in the company. And I started, as Paula said, I did study telecommunication engineering. My objective was to do the engineering studies that were more difficult in Barcelona, not civil engineering because my brother was doing civil and I thought it was too much. Industriales, you know, was like, oh, it's the Maria, you know, so like, let's do telecos. And I really had the dream to become the Telefonica president. That's how I started. The reality is that in a summer, my father was sick and I had to stay in Barcelona, and one of my colleagues told me, you know what, I am studying in this company in the summer. Like, they are super fun. There are a lot of young people. Why don't you join? And since then, and in fact, this was when I was on third grade of telecommunications. So if you count, you can add two more years to my background in HP. After this, the beginning really in HP was as an engineer, customer assurance, product marketing, where I did learn a lot about what product marketing is and the technology. And I become extremely fan of what product marketing and innovation process are. Then after that, I moved to Asia Pacific. So HP asked me if I wanted to move to lead the sales organization in Asia Pacific and Japan. And I did move there for 2 years, working from Singapore, where I learned really what value-added sales are and how difficult it is to sell. So up to now, I had been in HP just developing products, you know, and like saying this is how it had to be sold. But the moment you go and start selling, you know, like it's a completely different story. So I had to develop, like I did in the global business units, I said, for this product, we're going to be selling in Asia that amount, and then I had to go there and sell. Extremely tough. After that, there was a position in Palo Alto in the States, and they asked me if I wanted to join, and there were two types of jobs. The first job I did was the service global business unit manager. At that time, service for HP was just selling extensions of warranty. So if your product or printer had 1 year warranty, 2 years. And then I did develop the first service that was called HP Smart Friend, that it was a subscription service for elderly people so that they didn't need to call their sons on how do I print from my computer. So that's one. Second, and was more interesting, they asked me to manage the desktop business. The desktop business, I'm sure that some of you, since you're very young, you think they don't exist. It's these big towers that you see in banks. It's a huge market. And they asked me, like, now HP is looking in the office of the future, you know, so like, and you are the owner of this business. It was extremely tough to reinvent it, you know, and what we did is we changed completely the size, the look, and the functionality of a desktop. So we decided that the desktop unit was not going to be not only for doing towers, but really to bring computer to places with additional functionality. from audio, and suddenly we started putting computers into conferencing room to manage, you know, the, from the audio to the screens to everything. So that's, you know, like some of the things. And last but not least, 1 year ago, when now it's almost two, in June, like they asked me to, well, there was an opening in corporate, I don't know if you know, but like they don't give you things, they, you need to apply. So I applied to the global general manager for the large format printers in Barcelona, you know, like the large format printers that they produce posters or drawings for architects. So that's, you know, like what I did. How did I do it? With two things. First, I have a family support. I'm extremely lucky. My husband decided to stop working and follow me, which is not always easy. And my daughter has been in 6 schools. She's 15 now. And she has not complained, which is very good. So without them, I could have not done it. And second, which I wanted to share, is related to the culture that the founders of HP did. That's why I was able to work, because they believe in diversity. And also, they have this capacity, you know, they believe in people growing. And let me share a video on when Dave and Hewlett, they started HP as you, as a startup.
There's this story of two people in a garage on Addison, and they were tinkering on the weekend, and they're engineers, and they built this billion-dollar company.
Bill and Dave encouraged people to be brave enough to take the risks and think as large as possible.
These guys built a process that invited, accepted, and rewarded innovation. There were multiple people in every department of the company doing innovative things. The essence of the HP way: top management sets the overall objective and then gets out of the way and lets the people do it.
HP set the standard for the rest of us. They became, in my mind, the icon of, you know, what business ought to be.
So this is the origins, you know, of the company that I'm lucky and proud to work. But as I said, now I'm the general manager, you know, for large format print, and we need to accept the disruption. And like I'm sure you think, what are you going to be if you're printing now? Like, printing is gone. So, well, I tell you that there are some reasons to believe, so we need to transform. So I started the job and said, say, and now what? How are we going to disrupt and think differently on the large format business? So one thing that I did is, first, I wanted to understand very well what this organization was. The organization in Barcelona, I don't know, like if you know it a little bit, is an organization that started many years ago with extremely high talented people that they have been reinventing themselves for many years. So they even created the 3D business that now is like a global movement more than a business. So very extreme good talent, very committed, but certainly there were things that we needed to change. So I set myself a goal that was, how are we going to reinvent the business in a way that no one could recognize it? And with 3 main outcomes: we wanted to have new concepts, we wanted to have new delighters, and we wanted to really have real engagement from the people. These were the 3 goals. So what did I do? And I do believe in a lot of things for innovation, but there are 2 that for me are fundamental. One is the process. I do believe that anyone can innovate if there is the right process. It's like what they say, no? Not everybody can be Picasso, but everybody can paint. So that I do believe the same. So with this in mind, And I'm sure you are very familiar, you know, like with all the methods, you know, that there are for innovation. So I did look and learn over my career on design thinking. Now you will think that it's pretty old, but it still is the basis for many of the innovation process. Second, it was the methodology for lean startup from Eric Ries. But then I read the book Abundance. Who has read the book Abundance? No? Make a picture and read it. So Abundance is a book, you know, like written by Peter Diamandis, which they show, or it's between a religion, I'm saying, and a philosophy, where they say that the future is brighter than you think, because now the technologies that are available at the scale for everyone are going to solve the major world issues, from education, water, pollution, health, so everything. So that's the theory. And what they wanted, these guys, was to make sure that they have an impact on 1 billion people. And what they did is they created Singularity University. Who is familiar with Singularity University? Anyway, Singularity University is a university in Palo Alto that really what it takes is the singularity principle, the abundance principles, and they apply it into training. And what they do is they invite many startups so that they are very knowledgeable about the technologies, and then they can impact, you know, like, and solve the world problems. With this, they started doing this, but they saw that it was not enough, that they wanted to move this knowledge of singularity into the corporate. And some of the founders, well, in fact, it was not a founder, it was one of the principals at that time, Salim Ismail, decided to found a company called ExoWorks. And last September, I met them, and they had already been doing four what they call exo sprints in corporations. And I say, you know what, I'm going to take the risk and run this process of ExoWorks with you in large format. So how did we do it? The first thing we did acknowledge, you know, like that is half time. Yes? Perfect, thank you. So we did acknowledge, you know, like the disruptions that are happening in our market, accept it. So for you, that like you come into this startup world, probably this is nothing. But for the organization in corporate, for the employees to understand that we do see the disruption from the leadership team, it was a big aha. And by the way, this is helping us not only develop new products for today, because now the competition may be more this than other traditional competitors, Canon and Epson. And second, it helped us really visualize the future. So that was the first thing, is acknowledge the disruption. Second, there is a formula in ExoWork that is called the MTP plus scale plus ideas. And for that, I'm going to run a video, you know, that is a 2-minute video where Salim himself explained this methodology.
The first and most important is what we call a massive transformative purpose, or your MTP. This is your why, what gets you up at 6 a.m., it's what inspires you, what gels a community around you. Next, we have staff on demand. The industrial age is over. Even big companies like EMP are now outsourcing what they can. This makes your company agile, flexible, fast-moving, and super cost-effective. Then you have community and crowd. And EXO builds systems to get the best people to come to you. They learn how to leverage growing communities to scale faster and bigger than at any time in the history of business. The fourth is algorithms. The best EXOs leverage data and algorithms to scale in ways that weren't possible even 5 or 10 years ago. Google's PageRank algorithm earns more than $1 billion a week. UPS saves $1 billion a year by routing 55,000 trucks efficiently with an algorithm. Number five is leveraged assets. Own only what's absolutely critical and outsource everything else. Think Airbnb being the largest hotel chain in the world without owning a single property. Or Uber, a taxi company that owns no taxis. And number six is engagement. You can track in real time how users are interacting, what's working in your marketing, and get feedback on how to improve and where. You're engineering the behaviors you want from your community. The seventh one is interfaces. Big data is big, and an EXO chooses its data wisely. Filter the external chaos into usable and actionable information. That's how you stay agile while scaling. Number eight is dashboards. EXOs are very data-driven. Companies like Walmart, who track all inventory and credit card transactions in real time, they know the instant something happens and they can react very fast. Number 9 is experimentation. An EXO is constantly iterating on everything and takes calculated risks to test the boundaries of what's possible. They think, measure, test, iterate, and they do it very, very fast and in real time. 10th is autonomy. The old industrial business model is completely outdated. Zappos employees do absolutely what it takes to keep the customer happy. Mindvalley is a fun, flexible workplace built on love. These are what make an EXO faster and more accountable with amazing morale. And finally, number 11, social technologies. Social platforms like Slack, Yammer, Chatter that allow EXOs to make fast decisions, leverage community, and enable peer-to-peer interactions. This is a brief rundown of the 11 attributes that would make up an exponential organization.
So we are lucky, you know, because they say the theory says that for a corporation, you just need to apply 4. But for the startup, you need to apply them all, okay? So that's what the theory says. So anyway, with this in mind, so we learned what this methodology is. And what we did is we select the people, you know, that had to run it. The organization that I'm managing in Barcelona, it's around, like, if it's all the large format business, it's around 500 people. And we selected 28 of them. And we selected making sure that we had the most diverse. We created one team that was millennials only, so people that had been in the company very little time, and that they did not know everything, but that was excellent. You know, so what's one of the best decisions? And then we had people from all the departments, from all the ranges, from all as many countries as possible, the most diverse. And when there was one rule, when you were entering into a team, there were 4 teams, you needed, you know, to break or to just forget what is the organization role that you have. If you are the R&D lab manager, there you were not the R&D lab manager, you were just Albert. So I think this was a lot of, you know, like a new way of working within corporation. Second, we rerun the process, which it starts with many like learnings and what we call the awake session. On the awake session, if you have not seen him, I encourage you, like there are, Salim Ismail has many of his speeches, you know, on YouTube. So we start with the awake session, then we did training. We did explore many ideas, and the interesting thing is that we had the opportunity, the teams had the opportunity to really look at externally experts on different areas. What if I want to do a printer make with drones? So they could connect, we know, with experts related to the different areas that they were interested. And the most, and week number 5, what we did is we invited real VCs, okay? Some of them like Augusto, some of them, you may know them. And then we did like the Shark Tank, for those that, well, I'm sure you know on it. What we did is we invite them, and they started, every team had to select 4 ideas, and then they started judging them. Good, bad, this already exists, you haven't looked, etc. So what we did, and I cannot spend a lot of time, I can tell you that these were, I'm removing names, you know, because if not, they will kill me at home. Because there are very, we got many ideas, like should we print as a Roomba printer on the floor? Should drones print on the walls? Should we change from printer to services? Should we, like, use the technology that we have for printing to nanotechnology, for cosmetics? There are printing tattoos. There were many, many, many ideas. 4 of them, we sponsored them, which means that like within the large format organization, and I cannot tell you which ones, within the large format organization, what we did is we sponsored some of them. And now there are engineers incubating a startup within the large format business, but protected. So they are the lucky guys, you know, like they don't have the risk that you do, but they are really starting a business. So this is running, you know, like the story. But then let me share with you the last, the learnings. First, you know, like as I said, the day in the life of corporate is different than the startup, very different. But there are things that I think are common. First, there are a lot of roadblocks. Personally, I can tell you that I have to move across the globe, move my family. So my career itself has not been easy. And neither has been the businesses that I have been managing. But what are the learnings? One, the company culture, so that HP has helped me be very proud and do my best myself and the organization. As I said, it's all about the people that you work with, that you work for, that they work for, or that you work with. It's around, it's all about the people. And the third thing, it's a reflection, you know, that I have done this year related to the leadership style, and I'll explain you in a minute. On the company culture, I'm sure many of you, like in the startup world, many of you, you just want to sell and make money, which is very honorable. You know, I wish I could do it, but I'm in corporate. But I think it's also very beautiful to know that 80 years after Hewlett and Packard found, you know, two guys a startup, there are two huge companies, each of them of 50 billion, where we are making each, like this is just the numbers for Hewlett Packard, you know, HP split it into two, Hewlett Packard and HP. So in the HP side, we are around 50 billion, and we are giving work, you know, for 55,000 employees. It is very nice, you know, to see this culture and this company alive 80 years later. We know innovation is our heart. And every one of us in the different business units, we try, you know, to get the disruption in the best way. Everyone can be innovative if the process is the right one. Third, I think like in the culture, we do believe in diversity and helping the community. And I'm not going to run the videos for the sake of time, but HP here in Barcelona, we are dedicating a lot of time to promote diversity, to promote STEM in the schools, and to promote sustainability. And for that, let me run a video on sustainability.
Pays né pendant après 12 janvier nous venons vivre en battante. Je ne bats de personne, c'est mon cap. Continue, c'est mon maman, c'est mon papa. À vous, mais pour moi, c'est à prendre un bail pour arriver plus devant. Mettez-le dans le ballon. Mais voyez-le ça. D'abord, pour nous faire plus de mouvement, plus de mouvement, plus de passer ça, pour nous capables de nettoyer le pays avec Pogina et Abomasia. Moi, je joins tous les petits amis qui viennent nous aimer. C'est là dans nous payer l'école, c'est là dans nous payer caille, c'est là dans nous voir tout le l'école, c'est là dans nous faire tout le bagaille net. Je viens changer dans la vie, moi je viens entrer dans sa bouteille qui fait nous devons payer, nous payer caille, payer caille.
Anyway, so I think like it is very important the culture of HP, diversity, sustainability, as well as innovation. But as I said, it's all about the people, all of it. So think, I don't know if you have also read a book that is called Who Do You Bring Into the Bus? And this one explains it is very important the team and the people that you decide to work with. It is not the same if your adventure is to go to the mountains. You need to decide people that know how to get there. If your adventure is to get to the beach, you need to decide who can really be in the beach. So you need to really decide who goes with you. And it's one of the most difficult things as a leader, as a manager, and as a colleague to really decide. I think it's important, as I said, that you believe in the diversity of the people that are around you. And these are three principles that HP wrote in 1940. A diverse, high-achieving workforce is a sustainable competitive advantage. So this is not for today. As I said, you know, like innovation has to be part of everyone. And if you look at the process that I explained you today, you can see that all the new processes of innovation today, they need people with different skills. They need empathy. They need people that can be adaptable, flexible, collaborative, and that they can live with subjectivity. And if you think about it, I'm sure that you can see that the future of innovation will be with women. But as I said, just remember one thing, it's all about people. And to finalize, I wanted just to close with some personal remarks related to leadership. So there are many different leadership styles. And Ferran Costes, you know, like there are many, many models, but doesn't matter. Let me finish with the story. There are different models of leadership. And if you look at this axis, you know, this model, differentiates people between the ones that like make the decision in a super rational, only factual base, and those that are more experienced, emotional, and those that are more reflective, you know, like so they before they act, they reflect a lot, and those that are like more active, you know, and like they act and then decide almost, okay? So like these streams. So if you look at today, this is like a model, and the majority of the leaders we have had they start on earth, so all our financial, even Jesus Christ, I always say, is an earth person. Usually, like the male are on the top, you know, and there are earth and fire, okay? That's how we are. That's the majority of the leaders we have had. But there are many other. I'm for sure air. And this doesn't mean that it's different, best or worst. It's just different. And it is very important to then understand your impact. So it is not the same, the impact that I create as a leader, if you are fact and active, that if you are more emotional and active. It's different. It's not better or worse. But it is important that each of us, as leader or the organization or your startup or your community, you reflect. Think always people first. For me, it has been one of the biggest learnings, how much I can learn from every single person that I work or see or visit. I think it's important that we all grow. So I have had to change personally many things in my style, many things, because I understood the impact, positive or negative, that it had. And always, no matter what, be yourself. And to finalize, you know, and I'm sure you have seen, you know, like some doses of one of the key messages, I want to ask you for a personal favor. I know in this world, there are not that many women as we should. The world is, even in the startup world, is not as diverse as it should. So I want to ask you for a favor. If you work with a woman, trust her more than what you think you can. Coach her. And not only on the what, how they are doing the things, but on the what, give her a lot of knowledge for her to grow and accept different leadership styles. They are different, they are not worse or better, just different. So to finalize, what type of culture do you want your company to be? Thank you very much.